All right. For resubmission. So basically, what's going on here? So there is this administrative, there is this directive. So generally speaking, the customs, if customs rejects entry summary, the exporter, or I'm sorry, the filer, the importer, or the customs licensed customs broker filing on his behalf has two working days to do the correction, right? So remember that 10-day window that gave where you have to file 7501 with deposit, right? So the customs, the position of customs is that we give 2 working days to resubmit entry summary, right? However, for example, if you have 10-day window, if the rejection, if you submit it on 5th day and you get rejected, you still have 10 days to submit, so it's within a time frame, right? But if you the entry summary is rejected on 9th day, it is due on the 12th day, so you still have that administrative discretion by customs, right? That two working days to resubmit the entry, right? The exception to that 2 working day period is anti-dumping and countervailing duty cases, where regardless, and here is the punchline, regardless of when they are rejected, those summaries must be resubmitted to customs within 10 working days from the date of reject. So for example, so 142.12, if I am not mistaken, let's take a look. Remember that ECFR that we discussed, that 142.12, that 10 working day rule, right? 10 working days after the entry. So that's the key to keep in mind. The interpretation is over here. So entry is made here. So 3461 is filed on day 1, working day 1. Working day 10. This is working day 10. When you have to file 7501. Plus duties and all that stuff, right? You file it on working day 9. So customs discretion extends it to working day 11. Right, if it's a regular duty, so you actually extend it beyond the time allowed, right? And the reason for that is you still did your submission, right? You still complied with this provision, but it was rejected, right? So in other words, you have it's an administrative discretion timeline. Okay, fine. So the rejection has been made. You have two working days, right? But if on working day 9, if this is a regular, right? Let's say type 01 entry. However, if you have for type 03. If you have anti-dumping duty, you have 10 days. So according to this message, you have, regardless of when they're rejected, so if they're rejected on working day 9, they must be resubmitted within 10 working days from the date of reject. So you take 9 plus 10, it will be working day 19, right? So that's the point customs is trying to make. How do customs examiners test you on this particular matter? Let's take a look. A broker has blank days from the date of reject to resubmit a summary that is rejected for failure to post a bond cash for merchandise. So there was a bond issue, right? So so customs rejected an entry. So go get a bond or go make a pay, make a cash deposit as required. How many days to fix this issue? Well, going to surety, doing all this application may take time. So you have 10 working days, right? You have 10 working days as described in that directive to come back and resubmit the entry summary. Of course, with money. So E is the correct answer choice here. If it was a regular, not anti-dumping duty, right? But it was a regular entry, you would have the answer choice B, or depending if you are within that window, it would be within that window. However, this one makes it 10 working days, that irrespective of the day of reject. So this timeline is irrelevant because it is a type 3 entry. So E is the correct answer choice over here. Reimbursement. So now we get to the reimbursement. So basically, the deal is this. You have to... sneaky exporters may have figured out and they say, hey, listen, let's make a deal. They tell the US importer. I am going to give you sell you the merchandise subject to anti-dumping duties, but I'll incorporate the cost, or I'll reimburse you for those duties because they're so high you can't bear them. I'll make sure that you pay for them. I make sure that you do not suffer as a result. So it's on me. Anti-dumping duties are on me. That's a reimbursement. And the goal of the anti-dumping duty and countervailing duty law is to prevent this merchandise from entering, to allow to kind of even out what's called an unfair effect. Well, the law looks at this as making a runaround, and to prevent that, the customs law says, or the anti-dumping duty law says, if the exporter or producer reimburses you for the anti-dumping duties, then we're going to double that. We're going to double the reimbursement. So and to make sure that you're honest, you're straight with us, we're gonna have to file a statement, because if you do not file a statement that you are not the importer of record, the importer who has to pay anti-dumping duties, if they don't file a statement, then we're going to presume automatically that you were reimbursed. A lot of issues took place. The regulations say we may presume, but the administrative position taken by Commerce, taken by Customs, is that we must presume. And because of that, let's see, this is a regulation, 341.402. Instead of me talking about it, let's just go to that regulation. So that's Commerce, 402. Oops, I think. Was it? Not 41. So I was right on point. 351.402. Okay. Reimbursement. Presumption. Secretary of commerce may presume. See that may presume from the importer's failure to file a certificate of reimbursement described above. We'll talk in details. That the exporter or producer paid or reimbursed the anti-dumping duties or countervailing duties. That word may is inferenced as must by customs. So before, like in the early 2000s and before, in like in the last century, right, in the 90s, 80s, that may was discretionary, right? But customs has since then took a tougher stance, and when already high anti-dumping duties double as a result of failure to file a piece of paper by the importer who was not reimbursed, already prohibitive anti-dumping duties just became impossible to bear. So this is a significant issue, and this is an issue that you must be mindful of. And when does it have to be filed? It has to be filed before the entry liquidates. So we know anti-dumping duties take time to liquidate, but it's better to file before.
Let's see how. Customs examiners test on this.
U.S. Department. So that's an example I talked about, right? Okay. So this is just an example of breakout. So this is how they double. So to avoid this, you have to file a certificate of reimbursement. You can file a blanket, and it must be filed prior to liquidation. So customs examiners can. Well, it's a straightforward exam question, but. You just need to be mindful of. What additional information is required when filing an entry subject to anti-dumping duties? A certificate for / statement of reimbursement, yes. 351-402 was right on point. This is required and to avoid that presumption. 351-402. Application to manipulate, examine sample transfer goods. No. This is a transportation entry. No. Origin. No. Allowance. Allowance is like when your goods is damaged, right? So you say, okay, this is we have a problem with this. The container leaked, so the appraisement value should be different. This is done through this form. So that's different animal, if you will. So those are the buzzwords that you must be mindful of. Next. So CBP form 75, so start with a question first. Blank must file a reimbursement certificate or countervailing duties prior to liquidation. Who must file, all right? Well, from the outline, we know that importer of record must file a certificate. Importer of record. So we already know of call of the question. So when we go to the fact pattern, we're looking for importer of record, IOR. Who is it? Who is that person? Who is that entity? Big Dragon Imports, Taiwanese non-resident importer of record. So Big Dragon Imports is IOR. Even though it's Taiwanese non-resident, can non-resident entity be an importer of record? Answer is yes, it can. Power of attorney requires this series of process. You need to file for special importer identification number, special number customs may assign to you, but still employer ID, EIN number, employer identification number. But still, it's not a problem. The
the problem may be with the service of process, but through power of attorney, customs is just going to serve the service on the broker, and that takes care of that. So that's not an issue. So non-resident can be an importer of record, and that's fine. PRC International Group, an incorporated legal entity in the customs territory, and ultimate consignee, right? So ultimate consignee is not the importer of record, it's just a receive party. So PRC International Ultimate Consignee. Red Garments, Chinese overseas manufacturer, subject to anti-dumping duty order of 15.2%. So Red Garments is exporter. West Texas CHB Access LCB, but we know who must file. Importer of record, which would be that BDI, right? Big Dragon Imports. This guy, Big Dragon Imports, is importer of record, has to file. You can have broker file it on your behalf, but it still has to be executed, signed by this entity. If it's done electronically, the broker, the licensed customs broker, right, must have the original on file. So this is something which is has a higher burden of delegation, if you will. So let's take a look. Who must file importer of record? Who is the importer of record? It's Big Dragon Imports, right? Big Dragon Imports. So D is the correct answer choice. So keep in mind that importer of record must file certificate of reimbursement or non-reimbursement. Sometimes they're like interchangeably called. AN blank is required prior to liquidation of anti-dumping duty or liquidation order, certificate of manufacturing, sellership, reimbursement certificate. Those are the buzzwords, big time. It was a huge deal. Now it's more or less settled, everyone learned the rules. There were a couple of court cases litigated. So now it's not an issue, but back in late to mid 2000s, this was huge.